We ask now that you send down preaching power. We ask that you increase that I may decrease. We ask that you take my ego down to zero. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us. Sir, so we will see Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Let something be said or done. That someone comes running, saying, what must I do? What must I do to be saved? And we'll be sure to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And all the blood washed believers said together, amen. Giving honor to God, who indeed is the head of our life, to Jesus, who is the Christ, the Holy Spirit, who is our comforter, to my brother, my friend, and my Murphy's brother, Pastor, none other than Pastor R.W. Disciple. Y'all give him a hand clap of praise. Always, I want to thank him publicly as I have privately for this precious preaching opportunity. Amen.
Amen.
My mother has always told me, folks do not have to be nice to you. But whenever they are, you ought to be kind enough to say thank you.
Yes.
I thank you as always for this precious privilege to all these beautiful kids who joined me on the roster. I must agree with the words of Peter when he stood on the Mount of Transfiguration. It's just good to be here.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but a lot of places I could have been. Some of those places I should have been. But I thank God that he allowed me to come to worship one more time. I would not follow you long on this morning. I want to look at a very familiar passage of scripture. It's so familiar that I pray that you don't go to sleep on me this morning. Amen. The gospel according to Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse number 13. Matthew chapter 14, beginning with verse number 13. I will be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. Matthew chapter 14, beginning with verse number 13. Matthew 14 and 13. Reading from the New King James Version Bible reads this way. When Jesus heard it, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the multitudes heard it, they followed him on foot from the cities. And when Jesus went out, he saw a great multitude, and he was moved with compassion for them and healed the sick. When it was evening, his disciples came to him, saying, this is a deserted place, and the hour is already late. Send the multitudes away, that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. But Jesus said to them, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. And they said to him, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. He said, bring them here to me. Then he commanded the multitudes to sit down on the grass. And he took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he blessed it and broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, and the disciples gave it to the multitudes. So they all ate and were filled, and they looked up the 12 baskets full of presents that remained. Verse 21, now those who had eaten were about 5,000 men besides women and children. And if you're not too mean, before you sit down, reach over to your neighbor and say, neighbor,
old neighbor,
old neighbor,
old neighbor,
Jesus will,
Jesus will
meet your need. Jesus will meet your needs. In 1972, the recording artist Bill Withers penned these words. He said, we'll all have pain and we'll all have sorrow. Okay, you're not familiar with that part of the song. He went on and said, lean on me.
Right, right.
When you're not strong,
all right.
I will be your friend to help you to carry on. He went on and said, just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I wish I had been preaching this morning. Bill Withers penned these words in 1972. 1972, it was true that everyone needed somebody to lean on. And just to bring you up to speed, even here today in 2016, we all need somebody to lean on. I know we come a very long way. You like to tell people that you're self-made, but I tell you, if you're self-made, you're only half-made, because there's a part of your life that still haven't been touched by somebody else. I know you said, I never said I was self-made, but I tell everybody, I pull myself up by my own bootstraps. Well, if you pulled yourself up by your own bootstraps, I have two things for you. Firstly, you haven't pulled yourself up far enough yet, but secondly, you couldn't pull yourself by your own bootstraps because you didn't make the boot nor put the strap on the boot that you pulled yourself up with. And if you don't mind helping me preach this sermon, turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I can't make it on my own, and you can't either. He said, lean on me. That was not only true in 1972, not only true in 2016, but it was also true for these 5,000 men, not including women and children. They needed somebody to lean on. I mean, I don't want you to miss it. Here it is. They are in need in a deserted place. When I ask you this morning, have you ever found yourself in need in a deserted place? I mean, have you ever found yourself up late at night and nobody's answering the phone? Have you ever found yourself laying next to your mate when you rolled over, they were sleeping like a baby? Have you ever found yourself with a friend trying to tell them your trouble and they looked at you like they didn't know what you was talking about? Every now and again, you will find yourself in need in a deserted place. I don't know about you people, I always said if you need me, I'll be there. And every time I called them, they were nowhere. What do you do when you find yourself in need in a deserted place? And that's the question I want to ask you on this morning. How do you handle life when your needs supersede your resources? I mean, don't fool yourself. We all have some mental needs. We have some physical needs. We have some financial needs. We have some spiritual needs. We have some emotional needs. But what do you do when your needs outweigh your resources? I mean, when your mental needs requires more than the medication than the doctor can prescribe. Or even requires more than the medication that you prescribe to self by the name of Jim Beam and Jack Daniels. What do you do when your physical needs require more than a good workout and a good diet? What do you do when your emotional needs require more than that girl, that boy, that man, or that woman coming to you? What do you do when your political needs require more than the candidates that's running? What do you do when your spiritual needs require more than once a week on Wednesday and coming back for 2 hours on Sunday? What do you do when your needs supersede your resources? I don't know who I'm talking to in here this morning, but everybody in here is in need of something. And the good news is that we serve a God that can supply our needs regardless of our resources. Now, y'all missed y'all shout cue in here. And there ought to be somebody in here besides me that's glad that we have a God that can meet our needs. If you're hungry, God can meet it. If you're sick, God can meet it. Is there anybody in here besides me that knows that you learned how to live, depend on the Lord, and He has met your needs? So here it is. Here it is. We are in this deserted place. In need. What do you do? When your life's needs supersede your resources. We come to this 14th chapter of Matthew, and here it is. Jesus went on to this deserted place, and everybody decided to follow Jesus. And that's a word for somebody here today. Wherever Jesus go, you need to go too. I don't care how far it may be. I don't care what's on that side of town. If Jesus go, I want to go with Jesus. That's done in all four gospels. I mean, read your Bible. It's in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And Pastor Si, but I ask myself, why is this the only miracle that's recorded in all the gospels? The Holy Spirit came to me and said, boy, really, the only reason this is the miracle recorded in every gospel, because I wanted everybody to know that God can provide anywhere at any time. Oh, y'all missed that shot. You got to understand, the gospel was written to
you're in the house or out the house.
Yes.
I don't care if you're in the church or you're in the world. We serve a God that can meet our needs. And I thank God because I wasn't in church all my life, dog. And I had somebody praying for me, and they said it like this, that he was better to me than I was to my own self. And is there anybody glad that we got a God that's been better to us than we are to ourselves?
All right,
man.
All right.
They're in need.
Yes, sir.
In a deserted
time. Right.
Yes,
and the disciples, they done just like we do.
Right.
They have their own plan.
Right. Come on.
They have their own agenda.
Right.
What do you do?
What?
When your life needs supersedes your resources.
Right.
Well, there's a few things in this text.
Tell us, brother.
About how Jesus meets our needs, I will share with you, and we can all go home happily together. And the first thing I see in this text is that Jesus' solutions aren't our solutions.
Look
right there, verses 15 and 16. The disciples said, send them away. Jesus said, no, they stay, you feed them. Don't miss that. The disciples said, send them away. And Jesus said, no, they stay, and you feed them. His solutions are our solutions. Can I be transparent this morning? I have been a point in my life where people sent me away. And every time they sent me away, I left discouraged. But even though I left discouraged, while I was on my way, I got to meet the encourager. I left discouraged. But on my way, I met the encourager. The disciples said, send them away. Jesus said, come to me. The people told me to get out. And Jesus said, all of thee who are heavy laden and labor, come unto me and I will give you rest. I wish y'all would help me preach this sermon here. Has anybody in here ever told you to get away from me? Has anybody ever told you to go and don't come back no more? Well, next time they tell you, say, well, thank you. I'm glad you sent me away. Because every time you send me out, I can count on God. When people come, send them away. Jesus said, no, they stay and you feed them. He told Isaiah that my thoughts are not your thoughts.
Right.
And my ways are not your ways. That's good news for somebody. The old church used to sing this song that I'm glad that man didn't make the sunshine. For surely he'll forget to let it shine on me. And I'm glad the man didn't make pain, but surely he'll put more on me than I can bear. And I just thank God today that God's solutions are our solutions. There's a story told of this elderly lady whose husband had died. And after he died, she just couldn't keep the house up like it used to.
Yes.
So over time, the floor began to squeak and have holes in it. The roof eventually started leaking and shingles were falling all over. The windows were old and somebody had thrown a rock storm and broke the windows. So the children came and said, Mama, I think it's time you come and live with us now. We want you to come and be with us.
Yes.
But the mama always sat on the front porch in a rocking chair. All
right.
And she never would quit rocking because she said, God told me to stay.
Yeah.
But you're telling me to go. And I'm just going to hang on in there until God shows up.
All right.
The children left mad, and you know how us children do when our parents don't do what we tell them to do, like we want something.
Right.
Right.
They went and told her siblings. So her siblings came and paid her visit and said, "What up, sis? I think it's time you come to the senior living with us. I mean, we're living in a brand new facility. Everybody you know is there. Just come on and have a good old time." Well, don't you know that woman, she never quit rocking. She told her siblings that God told me to stay. And I'm just going to hang on until my change. And you know what them siblings did? They just went on about their merry way, because people, every now and again, they'll come by and see about you. But a newsflash is, if you stay down too long, if you stay sick too long, people will forget about you. So here it is, the siblings quit coming. And eventually a storm was coming through the town. So the kids said, "Well, mama, I think it's time you come with us." The meteorologist said, "A storm is coming and we need to get you out of there." The mother said, "Well, you go do what it is you gotta do. But God told me to stay. And I'm gonna hang on till my change comes." Well, that storm came through and God did exactly what he said he would do, because he allowed the storm to pass over her house. But the storm went into the city and it started to tear up everywhere else they were trying to move her to. So one day she was sitting on her rocking chair, and on the front porch in a rocking chair, and a man pulled up in a black SUV. The man got out in a black suit, a white shirt, and a black tie. And that's a word for some man in here. Women like to see you when you're out on the suit. Told me one of the folks, they said, "We are distributors."
Yes.
and not manufacture.
Yes.
So listen, we are distributors and not manufacturers. See, I learned this because I went to H.H. Gregg and bought me a TV. And when I went to H.H. Gregg and got the TV, it was a bad TV. And you know, whenever we get things, we like children when they get a toy. We can't wait to turn it on. So I got this TV, and it was around college football playoff time. I had invited everybody to the house. So we're about to watch the games on my brand new TV. We hit the button, and the TV didn't come on. See, what the store didn't tell you was they can only guarantee it for 30 days. And any time after that, you gotta call the manufacturer. I called H.H. Gregg and said, "What's going on with my TV?" They said, "I can't answer that question, sir, but I can tell you you need to call the manufacturer." I didn't quite understand. I said, "What do you mean? I got my TV from you.
Right.
I think you need to fix my TV." I said, "Well, sir, you did get the TV from us. But we are only distributors. And you have to learn how to give it to the manufacturer." I'm not as fortunate as some of you. That anytime I buy a car, I have to get a used car. But the thing you need to know about a used car is there are used cars and then there are certified used cars.
Finish high school.
Well, I can't tell your testimony, but I can sure tell you mine. They told me to leave at 16 and just go get a GED. I said, no, I can't do that. I got to go ahead and finish high school. And now that I finished high school, I just celebrated my 10-year reunion just a few years ago. I went to my 10-year reunion, and I seen everybody I went to school with. I mean, they all graduated ahead of the class. But the good news was that none of them really finished college. I had my BA. None of them went to grad school and had my master's. So now I'm working on my doctorate. And if you can't shop for yourself, somebody ought to be able to shop for you. Secondly, he meets our needs because man has limitations. God doesn't.
That's right.
But thirdly and lastly, Jesus meets our needs because there are some things only he can do. It's right there in your Bible. I hope you didn't close. Look at verses 19 through 21. He made them to sit down. He took the bread. He took the fish. He broke it. He held it up. He blessed it. What are you saying, boy? There's some things that only God can do. See, we spend too much time trying to do things our way. But sometimes we got to learn how to do things God's way. Some of you wonder why you haven't got the promotion because you ain't gave it to God yet.
What you say?
I'm glad the only God can take nothing.
Yeah.